Our body, our consciousness, our awareness are such magnificent forces in play. If you pay attention to them, if you understand their flow, you will not miss any opportunity to attain that self-realization. When you understand the play of your consciousness, the divine is not difficult to find, but it becomes impossible to avoid. That's the power of your consciousness. In this episode, I'll be sharing one powerful phenomenon that happens once a year. And if you play your cards right, it will change your entire life. I am Chandresh Bhardwaj, and this is Break the Norms. Namaste, everyone. I hope you have been well. Before we get into the topic for today, a deep gratitude to each one of you. Break the Norms podcast has completed 100 episodes. And what I find really fascinating about these 100 episodes, with each episode, I always thought maybe this is not the best one. Maybe this needs a lot of improvement. Maybe this is not my, you know, best voice, best version. And maybe I should re-record or edit. And every time I've released the episode and I've received your feedback, it always filled my heart with a lot of gratitude for accepting me as I am, for receiving my energy as it is, without ever giving me this pressure that I need to change something or I need to modify my expression. So this is a note of thank you for receiving me as I am. And you inspire me, you teach me to receive you as you are. And second quick note and invitation to all of you to visit leelagurukul.com and sign up for the announcements, because as soon as we are finished with editing of the program, the applications and everything will be out there. And my vision for Leela is absolutely going deeper, becoming more ambitious about how this venture needs to be out. And again, it's you who's inspiring me with all the feedback, with all the responses to the Sunday meditations and everything that you are watching and reading on the Leela page. In the show notes, the link is there. Also, you must have noticed we have added an email, askcb@leelagurukul.com. This is a dedicated email to receive all of your questions, comments, and those questions will be answered either on podcast or in a video, or if they are very personal, then you'll get a direct response. Now, coming to the topic for today, this is something that I truly feel is for the ambitious seekers. And usually ambition and seeking, they're not put together. And if you read or listen to the ancient masters, they will not put ambition and seeking together. But what I have understood about seeking, that you do need a little ambition. You do need that little fire, because seeking is the path of unknown. There is so much uncertainty, so much unknown element to it. And if there's no ambition, if there's no fire, you may get tired and exhausted pretty quickly. In fact, one of the words that we use for sadhana, for meditation, is tapasya, which means intense, very intense, disciplined practice. And what I'm going to share with you today is something that happens every month, but in this particular energy, it happens once a year. And those who have been working with me or following my work for a few years, you know that I talk about this very often. This phenomenon is called Shivratri, Ratri means night. And Shiva means many things. And that's what this podcast is really all about. Shiva Ratri, or this particular event, is called Mahashivratri, which means the big Shivratri. And Shivratri is the night to celebrate the higher consciousness. It's the night when the upsurge in cosmic energy is so strong, so intense, that something beyond your imagination can happen. But keep in mind, when these events occur, if you have never meditated, and this is the first time you meditate, or this is the first time you go this deep in meditation, a little change or a decent change will happen, a decent shift will happen. But for those who have been consistently meditating, something extraordinary will happen. Imagine an intense workout. If you do intense workout only once a month or once a year, that will give you pain, right? You might fall sick, you might break or fracture one of your muscles. But if you have been going through a decent workout every single day and go for intense workout once a month, then it will do something powerful. So that's how these events, these opportunities happen. And there is so much gratitude I feel for the ancient masters and gurus, because it's because of them we are aware of these opportunities. And Shivaratri is not a religious night. Although if you speak to Hindu Indians, you might, you know, feel that it's only for Hindus. But these kind of powerful nights are for everyone who's willing to go deeper, who's willing to really taste the ecstasy of their consciousness. It's for all. It's for everyone. And there are many layers to this episode, because I really want that you do understand the purpose, the significance of this powerful event, so that not only this year, but every year you can make the most out of it. And of course, my hope is next year, because Leela will be out in a few months, and every year on Shivaratri, we can do something together, because there are many things that need Leela kind of platform, and they're not possible on social media, not possible through podcast. So fingers crossed, maybe when we, you know, meet virtually through Leela or in person through Leela, we'll think about this podcast where, you know, I first shared this intention that on Shivaratri, Navratri, these powerful events, I really want all of us to, you know, meditate together and cultivate a collective consciousness. Now, before we talk about Shivaratri, let's talk about Shiva first a little bit. And I know in one of my episodes, I believe it was about Divine Masculine, or maybe specifically about Shiva, I have talked about him before. And I'm sorry, I'm not super organized in mentioning the episodes or titles, because they are so unscripted. As soon as I'm going to be done with this episode, I'm going to forget everything that I'm speaking. So it's a little unorganized, you know, realm of my mind. But I'm glad it's able to record a podcast for you. So first aspect to understand about this night is, who is Shiva? The more you research, the more you speak to people, the more complex it will become. Because someone like Shiva is multidimensional. You know, imagine someone in, you know, cinema who's a writer, producer, director, actor. And when you have to label them, it's difficult to label them, because you're like, they're doing everything. Maybe one day they'll release a movie where they'll be the only actor. That's how Shiva is. He is a multidimensional being, and no one knows about his origin. All the stories reveal one thing, that he was first seen in the Himalayas, in the mountains, and they are his home. My grandmother, whose name is Leela, she always used to say, you know, because she didn't know her date of birth, so whenever people asked her, you know, how old is she would always say, I'm as old as Shiva, because no one knows the origin of Shiva, you know, when he was born. And she always said, you know, no one knows when I was born. But that's what Shiva and his essence is. No one knows his first few years of life, that he was just seen one day. And that's how his glory, his power started spreading, because he was a multidimensional, unconventional, even for, you know, those ancient times. But there are plenty of wisdom scriptures, plenty of tantra temples in India where he is the supreme authority in that. And why Shiva is so significant, you know, for the seekers, for tantra, for the spirituality, because you could call him a scientific sage, you could call him a spiritualist who was also deep into spiritual science. Because everything that he has shared has a lot of roots in the spiritual science. In fact, one of the, you know, scriptures that I've always shared with you, Vigyan Bhairav Tantra, is created by him. And Vigyan Bhairav Tantra means the science of going beyond consciousness. And it is one of the most profound Tantra scriptures. And pretty much every scripture that I have studied and gone deeper, Shiva is everywhere. So it's safe to say without Shiva, Tantra would not be what it is today. He is also known as the founder, the first practitioner, the first guru of Tantra. That's why many teachers also call him Adi Yogi, which means the first yogi, the first guru. And this is why his journey, his role is supremely significant. When you speak to different people, they will relate to him in a different way. Majority of Hindu Indians, they do look up to him as the god, the ultimate divinity. Many Tantra gurus look upon him as the ultimate guru. And there's a particular sect of yogis and teachers called Aghoris. Many people are scared of Aghoris. Many people are very overwhelmed by their intensity. But Aghoris love Shiva and Shiva love Aghoris. And if you really have the courage to go deeper into the science of Aghori spirituality, it's a fascinating science. But, you know, just like it's an extended branch of Tantra. And you can imagine if simple Tantra is so misunderstood, then Aghori sect is supremely misunderstood and terribly misunderstood. But this is what Shiva is. His energy is intense, it's dark, it's healing, it's innocent. You know, he's also known as Bhole Baba. Baba means guru and Bhola means innocent. He's known as the innocent guru because, you know, the saying goes that when you start meditating on his energy, he is pleased very quickly. He starts to send you his energies very quickly. So all you need is that surrendering. All you need is that love for his power, love for his divinity. To explain someone as multidimensional as Shiva is a subject for plenty of episodes, plenty of books. To make your life easy and to make your sadhana, your meditation easy for Shivaratri, I'm going to stick to just one particular aspect of Shiva, and that's the aspect of healer and the conscious lover. Okay, these two are super important for this. The healer Shiva is one of the most profound forms of Shiva. In fact, some of the most powerful healing mantras, they are associated with Shiva. Anyone who's struggling with health, it could be mental health, physical health, it could be spiritual health, not going in alignment, you got to meditate on Shiva, not just on Shivratri, but every day. Anyone who's really ambitious to go deeper in their sadhana, in their meditation, you got to meditate on Shiva. For deepening the sadhana, for deepening your healing, Shiva's meditations are very powerful. And I can assure you, if you devotedly, deeply, and sincerely meditate on Shiva, then your challenges with mental health, physical health, spiritual health will start to fade away. But you got to have the patience. You got to have that devotion and discipline with it. It's not a steroid. It won't work overnight. And you cannot move into a need-based relationship also with Shiva. That's how we manage our relationships. And many people go deeper into the deity work with very heavy need. And you know, my friends, if you go deeper into sadhana with some rigid, heavy needs, they are going to become obstacle. You have to open your heart. You have to connect one-on-one with these energies. And that would happen with meditation, but by also learning more about these deities and not blindly believing, but really experimenting, really researching, experimenting, and really expanding your mind, you know, by learning more. But ultimately, it's not going to be a meditation bead or a stone that you wear or a crystal that you keep in the altar that's going to do the magic. Ultimately, it's going to be your sadhana, and everything else is just a byproduct, just supporting tools. And the other part I mentioned about Shiva was the conscious lover. Why Shiva would also be, you know, worshipped as conscious lover? Because Shiva is always seen with his partner Shakti or Parvati. And in Tantra, one of the forms we honor of Shiva is the form of Ardhanarieshwar, which is the masculine and feminine balance, the union of Shiva and Shakti. One of the most, or in fact, the topmost form of Shiva that's worshipped is in Shivlingam. Shivlingam is a symbolic form of the Shiva and Shakti together. It's an egg-shaped energy. And there are many interpretations of that. Many people say, or many teachers have said, that it's that perfect union of masculine, feminine. Other teachers say, you know, when you go deeper into meditation, you do become like Shivlingam. And, you know, having a Shivlingam in your altar is very powerful, but you should be ready to do good research and buy a very, very good quality of Shivlingam. And also, I have to say here, you know, I remember a very good friend of mine wanted me to accompany her because she wanted to buy a Shivling. And we were in LA. And I said, of course, I'll stop by and I'll help you, you know, buy the Shivling. And we went there. It was very expensive. Most good Shivlings are expensive because they are very, you know, they're handmade. They come from very powerful stones. And when I saw the Shivling they were selling, it was half Shivling. The Shiva part, the egg part, was there, but the yoni part was not there. And they were selling it to plenty of people every day. And I was like, this is absolutely wrong. Like, imagine you were sold a car without the engine and you were buying it because you were just told this is how the car works. And that's what was happening there. And I spoke to the owner and I said, you know, this is not Shivling. But owner was, you know, a white American. And she was like, oh, wow. And, you know, poor thing didn't know this was half Shivling. She said, this is what I've been sold and I've been buying and selling these. And that's where the problem is, right? That's why I said do proper research. And there were plenty of people who were buying Shivling in, you know, right there when I was in the store. And that's not Shivling. Shivling is the proper union of masculine and feminine. For Shivratri, you don't need to worry about it, but it's just something I wanted you to know, that Shivling are very powerful and they are considered the ultimate symbol of the higher consciousness. And those who are struggling with relationships, those who are struggling in finding the right partner or finding that conscious love, meditating on Shiva would be very powerful, especially for women. And many women I know who are in India, they do meditate on him a lot because their ultimate hope is that they, you know, should get a partner as powerful as Shiva. But also, let me tell you the truth, if you actually get a partner who is like Shiva, you will not be able to survive with him beyond 1 week, because the way we are, you know, conditioned to love is a very possessive, you know, need-based love. But when you love someone like Shiva, their love will be for, you know, all. It's a love that's very inclusive, not exclusive. And while many women I know who meditate and fast on Shiva because they want a partner like him, but also, are we ready for a partner like Shiva? That's another thing to really, you know, reflect upon. But it won't be a wrong idea to just put that intention out there that, you know, you are receptive and ready for that conscious love. So Shivratri could be the night where you meditate to go deeper in your sadhana, to deepen your consciousness, to be receptive to that ultimate magic and power that's already available to you. It's all around you, but you just have to open the heart, you know, and that's when it will happen. It's also the night when you could be really, you know, ready for planting the seed of conscious love, you know, first for yourself and then for others. So do not think of this night as the night for attracting a romantic love, but really cultivating the seed of that divine healing conscious love. And then it could translate into many things. You know, romance could be part of it, divinity could be part of it, poetry could be part of it. But you have to be open and receptive to how that, you know, unfolds. Because Shivratri is the night of strong natural upsurge in that cosmic consciousness. And when you are, you know, ready to go deeper, it will become available to you. And now I want to share meditation guidelines on how to make the most of your night in Shivratri. The next episode will be the guided meditation that you can use on Shivratri. And I just remembered, I haven't shared when is Shivratri. It's on March 11th. And in case you are ever confused, Google can help you in that. Just type Mahashivratri 2021 and you'll know the date. It's on March 11th. Now, here are a couple of guidelines that may help you to extract the maximum energy and strength out of this sacred night. Number one, if you cannot stay up all night, try to, you know, be in meditation for at least 1 hour, at least 2 hours. And those who can, try to stay up as long as possible. And then after meditation is complete, you know, just go to sleep. Do not indulge in, you know, any app, any social media, nothing at all. Just go to sleep after that. I would also recommend that you wear relaxed clothing. You could wear white because white color is very, you know, powerful in meditations. It enables that receptivity in a night like Shivratri. And there are certain rituals where the opposite of white, the black color is very powerful. But for this particular night, I would recommend wear something light, relaxed, where you can move your body. Don't wear anything tight. Untie your hair, you know, do not tie your hair. The hair are very powerful receptors of energy. And if you tie your hair during meditation, you might limit a certain energy exchange. So keep your hair open. You could take a shower if you want before the meditation, but have your food at least 1 or 2 hours before this meditation. Anytime after 7:30 p.m. Or 8 p.m., anytime after that, you could begin. If you can begin later than that, great. You know, I'm speaking 8 p.m. for those who sleep very early, but, you know, those who sleep late, you could begin, you know, as late as, I don't know, 10 p.m., 11 p.m. The late you go into it, the better it gets, because it is Shivratri, the night of higher consciousness. Keep a candle in your altar, have fresh flowers in the altar, maybe in a cup of, you know, in a small cup, maybe keep a little milk. And after the ritual is over, the meditation is over, you know, you could offer the milk to a plant. If you have a cat or dog, if they drink milk, you know, you could give it to them. But I would say do not drink that milk yourself, but give it to, you know, like offer it somewhere. Because every deity in Tantra is connected with certain elements, you know, in animals, in nature, in fruit, and all of that. So Shiva's elements are very earthy elements, you know, nature, green, snakes, milk, you know, very intense elements. I'm sharing this, just the soft ones, because those other elements, they're out of scope for the podcast purpose. And I don't want to put it here until I know who is listening and how we can manage that. But just for a good, powerful meditation on Shivratri, you know, keeping a milk in a small cup, a clean cup, not the one that you use on a daily purpose, but something that's, you know, untouched or something that's not, you know, casually used, you know, keep little milk there. It's an offering to those known, unknown forces. And when you start the meditation, the first thing I would recommend is keeping your energy receptive to the known and unknown. Also offering the gratitude for these known and unknown forces. And secondly, invite the Shiva consciousness. And when you invite Shiva consciousness, invite this consciousness in its masculine feminine form, in its union of masculine and feminine. And that would be a good time to plant your intention, the intention to deepen your healing, the intention to expand your consciousness, and any other intention that's connected with healing, or, you know, cultivating that conscious love, plant that intention. and then keeping your awareness on the heart. Go through a mindful, conscious breathing. Do that for a few minutes and then gently, effortlessly, raise the awareness from the heart toward third eye. And the mantra that you can do is Om Namah Shivaya. Very profound, popular mantra of Shiva. That's why I'm not sharing anything that's very tough to find. This one is easy, and the seed mantra of Shiva, Om Namah Shivaya. That's the mantra you can chant. You can start with the loud chanting and then go deeper. And as you go deeper, you become the mantra. You start to embody that Shiva consciousness. And keep going as deep as possible. This could be easily minimum 1 hour, and as long as you can. Keep little water next to you to drink, because these are very powerful healing meditations. And when you go intensely deep into these meditations, they do require more energy. Also, I would recommend, keep a new bed sheet for that night. And the purpose is keeping the room clean, keeping the energy clean in the room is very helpful to invite these energies. And next episode will be the guided meditation for Shivratri. And I hope everything I've shared today is helpful, and it will inspire you to be available to that powerful night of Shivratri. Thank you for listening, and see you in the meditation on Mahashivratri. I hope this podcast may travel through the untapped universe of your darkness, light, courage, passion, and so much more. Please do subscribe and be ready to break your norms. I am so excited and very honored to be part of your sacred journey through this podcast.